said good day, sir!
Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Grand Final for Defense, Season Number 3. I am TobiWan, and joining me is Cinderin. Welcome back, man. Game number 4, not far off starting. Are we going to have any predictions for this one? What are you thinking? What are you thinking now that Fnatic actually showed us that they know how to play in Game Number 3?
I think Fnatic has got some momentum going now. And as far as the draft goes, it's really hard to tell, but I think I'm going to call that this game is going to get really close. I have a feeling that Virtus Pro is going to get something that's going to work out better for them, and at the same time, Fnatic, now they've got some confidence, now they can maybe make some bigger plays and get things rolling. Mm-hmm. At least they proved in the last game that they're completely capable of being here in this final. And there's actually one thing about this matchup that I forgot to say earlier tonight.
Yep.
It's kind of funny that the finals of the Defense 3, this is kind of a new era in a way, in relation to what we've had before in the Defense 2, and that these two teams are probably the two Western teams that have improved the most over the last few months. So it's really cool to see both of them getting to the Grand Finals. Because Virtus Pro, a lot of dedication, a lot of practice and hard work. Like, I don't remember who pointed it out, but not with the biggest star players ever. I know NS goes a while back, and now they've acquired Ars-Art as a stand-in, if not a full member. It's not really confirmed yet, I think.
He's basically a full member. Okay. He's a full-time stand-in. We also, by the way, guys, bounced back out from the lobby. So somebody failed to load on this attempt. So everyone's going to bounce back, and we'll go win again. It gives us time, though. It gives us time. Guys, we said we would tell you how you can win. One of these guys, and also one of, I can't pick up the box. It's too slippery awesomely. Piss off. but also one of these guys. So you can actually win. This is literally the ones you win. So yeah, we got these guys. I think you also have a mouse mat that comes with all of this too. But yeah, more details for that one later. But how, if you want to try and win these guys, this is from Rocket, one of the big sponsors, in case right there or there, you can read it. Rocket, who sponsored this one, giving us our wonderful prize pool. Like, we're giving away $15,000 tonight.
Yep.
$15,000 go to these two teams. Who takes the 10K? Who takes the 5K? That's still a question mark. But your ways you can win this, tell us, Cinder, and preach the word.
Yeah. What you basically need to do to be able to acquire one of these is to tweet myself and Toby, as well as the stream link, and then write what your favorite moment of the defense was. And obviously, it's going to be kind of simple. You've got 140 characters since it's Twitter, so there's a limit to what you can say. But yeah, any sort of favorite moment it has could be something personal for you or just a cool play inside the tournament itself. If there's something you really remember from this this tournament. And
so, by the way, he's joinDOTA. If you don't know his name, it'll appear in the bottom, like, right-hand corner of your stream.
My nickname with DOTA after.
Exactly.
And you are TobiWan
with DOTA after. My nickname with DOTA after. Very, very easy to find. So include us both in the tweet as well as the live stream link. You can do it either straight to the joinDOTA one or wherever it's being shown. Like, you can go GGNet, you can go Team Liquid, you can go directly to Twitch, you can go on gamestreams.com, you can go to all these different places wherever you link it. Just link the live stream and do all that kind of jazz, and we'll pick the one which we like the most, could be most creative, picked at random. Normally the one we like the most, which is normally the one
we just... If there's one that stands out, and if we can't decide, we'll roll the dice.
We need a dice for that. And can we really have like a 500-sided dice?
Random.org.
Yeah, I like it. Random.org's always good. Meantime, game has started off. So let's jump ourselves inside the draft. It has finally managed to launch itself in. So we get to get down to business. To business, also for the guys out there who are now going
like on business.
Business, yeah. business is good, man. Business is good.
it's going to be the game number 4 now. And just to finish off what I started earlier about this, it's cool to see that both Virtus Pro and Fnatic has come such a long way. It was talked about in the pregame that Fnatic, a lot of people were really skeptical when they transitioned over from Heroes of New Earth and how well will they do, and they got bashed so hard in the beginning, and they've just shown what talent and dedication, how far it can get you. Arguably both Hani and Trixie, old school Dota players, so they have some background there, but both Aerofly and Notel, I don't think they've played any competitive Dota to my memory at least, but they've definitely made a breakthrough now, and it's cool to see them getting to this kind of final. And Virtus Pro might not be the same story for them in relation to transitioning games, but they also, in terms of star-studded roster, they have NS, who is really one of the stars of Russia, and they've just acquired Ars-Art. But apart from that, Tame My Wild, KSI, and Illidan, I don't know how many people actually knew these a couple of months back, but they've definitely made a big impression here. And I think so far in the finals, with Fnatic really pulling themselves together in that last game, I think we can definitely justify both teams being here in this grand final, because they've definitely delivered some really good plays at this point. And we're going to go into game number four. Virtus Pro taking the first two, which leaves them with a 2-1 after Fnatic really rolled over, you've got to say, that third game. That was very one-sided, actually.
Yeah.
Which I think surprised a lot of people. People were like, 3-0. Those two first games, Fnatic, they had a good lead. They still didn't make it work. Game three, we switch it up and just roll over.
I thought we were off to Meltdown to go have drinks like at the end of game number two. And then game number three, it's this jump off one side. It's kind of hilarious because over the last like couple of days, I've been sitting here casting possibly the most epic games of Dota we've ever had on a live stream. It's just gone on and on and on. It's been so amazing to watch at the same time. Now where we have these first two games where it's VP who just play better Dota. They just play better Dota. Even though at the start of game number two, it could have been questionable what's better Dota. But then Fnatic, they come out and then they go, well, okay. Well, you got to have game number one and also like the second half of game number two. We had the first half of game number two and we'll take all of game number three. Maybe game number four. How about we just share it down the middle and say everyone's great, everyone's awesome, everyone's going to play well.
I'm definitely hoping for a good game. Fnatic sitting on the first pick. We've got a couple of bans and picks to catch up on. Darkseer as well as Nyx being banned out by Fnatic. So again, getting rid of that Nyx Assassin. And Virtus Pro will be banning out Io and Keeper of the Light. And that's going to be a puck first pick for Fnatic. Seems like that's really the big hero of this Grand Finals. It's always funny to see when these specific matchups between two teams just develop their own kind of draft during the course of a best of five, because there's time to develop the strategies. And I think there's very few teams in the world that would pick Puck first over Batrider.
Yeah.
But it's what we're seeing right now. Batrider and Magnus are both available with Virtus Pro Desire to pick them up. You've got to say, you can really justify Fnatic first picking this, considering how well Tame My Wild played it in one of the games and how well Hani played it in the last one.
Yeah.
It's going to be a key hero nevertheless. Batrider, Nature's Prophet for Virtus Pro. We get the Prophet again as the second pickup, going for some global pressure here. And what is Fnatic going to go for against this?
It is actually kind of hilarious that we talk about the Puck right now, because I know a couple of nights ago I was having a bit of a discussion with Puppy, talking about like what is really like the best way for Team Finance Initiates, like what's really been the core workings of it. And he basically said that there's this caution in the whole EU scene where, like, for a Magnetor, for as the best example, you got one man that's there. You have a possibility of solo killing off someone like a Nature's Prophet or a Batrider. But you don't want to jump in because you want a 2-man or a 3-man or a 4-man or a 5-man RP. Give you the big, big hole and then just nail the crap out of everyone. And that's what's sitting in your mind. But you don't change the fight over straight away. So it doesn't become a 4v5 straight off the cuff because you've already nuked down one of these core heroes. And it buys time for heroes like Puck to find that space, to jump in, to get the silence. Your small hesitation, the second you see Puck, just nail him, destroy him quickly, and then move on to something else. And that's one thing which we saw in game number two and number three, where Puck was just stopping everything. Like, it was always this early blink dagger that came off. Like, it was 10 minutes in the last game from Hani when he managed to pick up that blink dagger. And from that point out, you try to initiate. You have heroes like Batrider, you have heroes like Nature's Prophet, but they can't move, they can't cast anything because that Puck is straight in the mix, and now you're going to combo it up with someone like Nyx, so we get a Nyx bomb proper, so you get the silence, you get the damage out with the Rift, and not to mention the Orb, if you do, you throw that one out too, and then you got the Infest damage on top of that, and then the one here that Nyx wants to focus on, and no one can do anything about it because everybody's silenced, trying to stand in one position or run away from, but then you can't, Puck ulti. What do you do? BKB is the only answer.
I like that it seems like Fnatic felt really confident with what worked out in the last game with that Puck and Chen. Getting those two picks again very early on. Magnus is actually so far going to go through the draft. Virtus Pro favors getting up the Lishrak. And I know exactly what Fnatic is aiming for right now. The question is if Virtus Pro realizes it. That third ban Anti-Mage as well as the Lifestealer really smells like a Storm Spirit, because he's amazing against all of Virtus Pro's heroes. Very few targeted disables, as a matter of fact, only one in that Batrider Lasso. And if Storm Spirit jumps in with an Nyx over the top, that's going to completely destroy Virtus. The nice thing for Fnatic in terms of banning strategy here is that when they ban Anti-Mage this early on in the draft, Virtus Pro might just consider it a general ban. one that they just don't want to play against for whatever reason, rather than a very strategic ban prepared for their last pick, or their fourth pick, right? If they would have fifth banned the AM after taking some time, Virtus Pro might think, okay, this is really a targeted ban, they want the Storm. But if they ban it this early on, Virtus Pro might not give it that much thought. They've got other heroes they want to ban out. They're going to ban the Bounty Hunter. And if they don't ban the Storm now, I tell you Fnatic's going to get it fourth.
You really think?
Yes.
Interesting.
Yes.
I'll be interested to see if it's going to be the case too, because right now, like, VP won't be thinking about that at all. It doesn't look like it'll fit into the lanes, not if you go with like traditional Fnatic.
I really think they will, but you're right, they have other... They kind of have some lanes set, but they could play an aggressive tri lane with the Chen Lifestealer, perhaps, mm-hmm. and get Storm Spirit either the easy lane or the mid. At least in terms of how it fits the overall strategy, it's amazing. But there is a little breach in the laning, that's very true, and that might actually knock Fnatic off that idea. But I think they're really thinking about it, I've got to say, because it's a great hero.
If they don't get the Lifestealer, they look for a different kind of combo. Like, that's probably the reason why the Bounty Hunter's been taken out, because you already, like, you've removed the Nyx in the early stage from No-Tail. He's already taken that one out. So they'll be looking for something else. They'll be looking for another hero that is basically going to be able to slowly move in, find Aegis Prophet out of position, all the Shrek. I'm actually even thinking, and I'm not quite sure why I'm thinking this, that Lifestealer is, in fact, not going to be a number one position. I'm thinking he'll start in the jungle, in the safe part of it, or he'll try and go on the solo of the top lane, depending on what VP pick up with the next hero. It's something which Fnatic have done a little bit here and there, but I'm thinking that just so you're able to get more core heroes up against what you got, Batrider, Lashrak, and Nature's Prophet. You're going to have to deal with split push, and very few of these heroes I'm looking at right now can deal with split push. Who is going to be your one man to jump around? It needs to be somebody who can take a decent amount of farm and move around the map everywhere you want to go. Either that, or they say, screw it, we push earlier on, and NS already moves that option with the Lycan taken out. There would be other options you can go down, but I think VP are the guys that want to make the most out of this. They've got Nature's Prophet and Lashrak. We're looking at tower melding anyway. The second there is an opening, second someone's not in position, they need some kind of global. And I'm thinking Tinker out of all of them.
He's also a good option. That's very true. He could definitely be one to deal with this as well. It's kind of a double-edged sword playing Tinker against Nature's Prophet, though, because they kind of counter each other. Mm-hmm. If you farm, TP out to farm with Tinker, you're always at the risk of Prophet TPing in with a Hex or an Orchid or whatever he's got.
Very true.
Batrider with a Lasso. But on the other hand, Tinker's also great for ganking out the Prophet globally.
Nailed it! So Puck becomes our solo laner.
Be right with the Lifestealer jungle. Then Puck is mm-hmm. solo mid, Storm Spirit solo bottom with a support.
Yep.
And with Chen, because what they're reading out of Virtus Pro's draft right now is that Virtus Pro probably doesn't want to go aggressive tri lane. They have Batrider and Nature's Prophet that kind of calls for one of them going to the jungle, right?
Unless Nature's Prophet goes up on the top lane solo.
They could do that and play Batrider mid and go an aggressive tri lane, which actually at this point might be a good decision for Virtus Pro, but it can also really easily backfire. In particular, if Fnatic runs that Lifestealer in the jungle early on, that tri lane down the bottom could be under a lot of pressure. But at the same time, then VP... Oh, well, we really got it, didn't we?
I think after Epi's been asking for about 3 to 4 games for this DK, he finally gets it. But don't worry, we'll watch the build, Epi. We'll watch the build.
Gotta get that stun.
and it's Illidan.
Gotta Illidan. Get the stun and stats, boys.
It's Illidan that talks about it, man. He's got a point to prove. He's got a point to prove. It's like, so what won this game? Well, it was my build, Illidan's build, on a DK.
It's cool, because if you do something weird or something special, you can always say that's the reason you won the game, right?
Yeah.
Because it's always that. Then it can't be the rest of the point.
No. There's no one else in this team apart from Illidan's DK right now. It's the one the eyes will focus on. Bring on the smack talk, and then NS will just start off going, yo, what's up? At the very, very start of the game. And then it's on like Donkey Kong.
I actually think it's going to be an offlane Puck now, thinking twice, especially with Virtus's pickup now. I'm not sure. It's still possible that Virtus Pro actually goes for an aggressive trial lane. And if they do that, the Puck will stand fine against whatever is up top, and they will be able to take a fight bottom with their Lifestealer trial lane.
Yeah.
Lifestealer Chen Rubick is actually really hard to go aggressive against. And, well, Storm Spirit will handle pretty much whoever goes mid.
It's actually kind of the funny thing, too. Like, you're saying Puck's going to set up fine against an aggressive tri lane. You go with the DK stun, you go with Lashrak Split Earth. Where's the damage coming from? Wouldn't it be great to have 4 points up in Dual Breath to have that burst damage?
Breathe Fire?
Yeah, Breathe Fire. Yeah, Dual Breath. Well, Shakira on the map? Wait, Shakira, pick up right now. Do it. make me sound right. But yeah, they actually had that burst damage. Because where is this damage coming from VP? Where is our damage dealer? Does it even come from like Nature's Prophet when he gets up later on? Is it meant to come from DK? There's nothing in this early point of the game that makes me go, whoa, VP is going to kill everybody. It's just VP is going to control everybody and then push down a tower and force Fnatic to come in close. That's what it kind of feels like right now.
And then they're going to all die to Dragon Tail. Fatal Bonds.
This is what I was looking for during the last game.
If he skills Fatal Bonds, he would better skill that Breathe Fire, okay? I swear. He had better skill that Breathe Fire.
We're going to find out, man. We're going to find out. But this is what we're talking about during game number 3, that Virtus Pro do like to run the Warlock ever since Dignitas. And yeah, you guys get to be trendsetters again. Started running the Spectre plus the Warlock combination. We go into a different scenario with the Warlock where he goes back into his old original role, the way people always thought of him as a support hero. And Ars-Art plays a pretty mean support hero, but now you've got to take it into account where they can almost run an aggressive tri-lane if they want to. DK, with his extra health build, and Warlock with Word, you're never going to kill him, man. You're never going to kill him. It's possible. It's doable.
DK with his extra health build. Oh. Yep. Let's call it the extra health build. I think Illidan is very flattered. Okay.
Yeah, obviously it's also technically unsound to call it that, I realize, because it's actually extra armor and extra regen. He actually doesn't get extra life points.
Extra everything but new power.
The extra build is extra. Extra, extra DK.
Extra less damage. we're going to have Notel playing as the Chen for Fnatic. Fly will be playing as Rubick once again. Era gets the hero he has played 7,231 times. Lifestealer. Trixie onto Storm Spirit. Hani gets his puck once more. He is indeed going to go with that offlane with the boots first and a little bit of pulled regen by Notel. Off on Virtus Pro. Illidan will skill stun on Dragon Knight. Ennis will be playing as our Lishrak. Smile. Ars-Art onto the Warlock. Tame My Wild on Batrider's solo mid. And finally KSI with that Nature's Prophet. And he's been pulled a Clarity as well as bought a Ring of Basilius and 2 Clarities himself. He's going power jungling right now. And that means this bottom lane for Fnatic is basically a freebie. And we could probably see them trying to run the supports a little bit rotating early on with
Hide Hani.
With Era there.
Hide Hani. This Treant hasn't seen him yet. He saw the Treant coming up and instantly hid behind the tree line, so he's not revealing out what the lanes are. And then now he just completely screws with that and shows the lanes. He wants to fight NS for this first rune, and it's an invis rune too. So now Hani's going to be even more scared up here on the top lane. But he's got no other option. This is always one thing I get a little bit concerned about when I see it, like a Puck or someone like that on the off lane. Where is the secondary option? Where is the secondary option for Hani? If top lane doesn't go right, what does he do? He can't go in jungle. Like crazy, if he was on the offlane, he can go in jungle with a Batrider, but there's no option like that. Rotating towards mid is the only thing, and that ends up hurting Storm Spirit more than anybody else.
The good thing for Hani, though, is that the supports up on top from Virtus Pro aren't really that good against Puck. There's a Lishrak who either needs to cast the Edict and then run in with it, and then Hani can just orb out, mm-hmm. or there's a Warlock who has absolutely nothing against him. So Hani will probably be able to get some experience up against Illidan up here. And Illidan, if he needs to be the setup for this, he needs to get in melee range with a Puck with boots, and that needs to be a big misplay from Hani to even allow Illidan to get in for that stun. So he'll be getting his, and even if he won't get that much, it's actually a valid point that Bulba made during last game in relation to Trixie's Darkseer offlane, who got really, really very little on that offlane. He still drew a lot of attention from the supports. Mm-hmm. And if Hani does that up on that top lane, if the Warlock and the Lishrak need to pay attention to him, that means that there's the possibility to push this bottom lane very early on. Era, together with a Rubick and a Chen with maybe one or two good creeps, could start pushing these towers. The supports from top will have to rotate. That's when Hani gets in.
I also noticed too, Hani's already screwing around with VP, and it's inside the jungle. KSI doesn't have his normal transition. Hani, with that invis rune, came up and warded the easy camp. So now Nature's Prophet, who is one of these heroes that always requires the easy camp to get farm, says, screw this, I can't take my farm in my jungle anymore, so let's go. We've got 1 point up on Edict for NS, use the Split Earth, clean up the creep wave, extra couple of trees from KSI, and let's just force out the towers. Let's just force out the towers. We've got a DK with the extra build. So there's no reason like that it's not going to work. An orb out from Puck, from Harney, actually pulls all the creep wave aggro off, but then new one will arrive. This will be the tier 1 tower going down, and we're 2 minutes in, and this is already possible.
Yeah, we're probably going to see Fnatic try to respond with it on bottom lane, or they're just going to take the sacrifice and be like, all right, you commit four heroes to taking this tier 1 tower, we're going to get an XP advantage for it. If you watch No Tail inside his own jungle right now, he's got a troll creep in level 3. He can take over the wildkin creep in that camp and basically tornado farm that, and maybe stack it once more even. And himself and Fly are going to get some really good experience here. Already 1,500 actually on the experience, 2.5 minutes in. This is really a big deal. And so the effective trade-off is gold for XP. And I think Fnatic can be okay with that because their lineup is so level dependent. Mm-hmm. The levels are actually worth more for them than items right now.
Well, looks like they are going to rotate people up. But hey, Rubick's already up at level 3 in comparison to the level 2 supports of Virtus Pro. Careful of Fatal Bonds, but with that Fade Bolt, pulls the aggro off, and then this push stops. KSI is basically out of mana. He's popped all of his clarity to keep making trees over on the side here. He's still got 3 minutes before that Observer Ward's going to disappear inside the jungle.
And meanwhile, bottom.
Yep.
Fnatic's trying to get the same trade-off. If they manage to get this tower, they've just got themselves a really good trade. Because then the gold is going to go to zero. It's actually going to go favor them. And they still have that 1.5 on the XP. Storm Spirit in the middle lane has got 11, CS Batrider's got 12, so that lane is going even. Lifesteal is out farming the DK, and the three bottom CS, actually Nature's Prophet, 3.5 minutes in, has 4 CS because he committed that much to pushing.
Yep.
That's going to be a late Midas.
I don't know if he's sure he's going to have enough time to pick up the Midas. He needs to, of course,
because they're
so far behind it. But they also need to defend the bottom lane, and now you see him TP down here. Delay it even further. This push can come. There's an undead army here from Notel. Create a couple of trees, but Eero goes, well, okay, we can clean these guys up before they pull the aggro. Okay, maybe not, but the new dire creep wave comes in, and they've got this tower just ticking down. It's down by 1/3 of its life points. Rotation's coming from Lushrike, but it's taking Ennis a very long time to get here. At the same time, Fly is being chased by Crazy. So Crazy napalming, and Fly goes, well, okay, guys, I just saw napalm fly at me. Oil's in the air. We need to fall ourselves back here. All we look for a Telekinesis is pick off. That tower is almost
it's
gone.
Dancing.
It'd be Michael Jackson shortly. More napalm, it's been moonwalking. But that tower's down to 220 of its life points. KSI and Ennis both forced to rotate, and
they're
now Harney's the one with space. I don't think they'll care if it's denied. There's a tier 1 and a tier 2 tower going down 5 minutes in against a lineup with Nature's Prophet, a DK who went the extra build, and then you've also got a Latrak who's walking around with Edict, and you get the tower advantage.
Yeah, it's looking very good for Fnatic right now. They got the start they were hoping for. Especially, we were a little bit skeptical about the offlane puck, how it was going to turn out. But the way it looks right now, Hani's definitely getting his up on the top lane. Trixie's now got his level 6 in the mid on Storm Spirit. So it's a role that's often really fragile when you play the Storm Spirit mid because he's so susceptible to ganks until level 6. But he got away with it without a death. The ganks from Virtus Pro just didn't come in because they prioritized pushing the top lane. And that means Trixie, he's got very few enemies in this game when you look at it.
Mm-hmm.
The stuns he needs to evade are melee. He needs to avoid the lasso, and he needs to avoid the dragon tail.
Mid-gank time. We got Troll set up, Flyer set up. The smoke's going to wear off in a little bit. They're waiting for Crazy or NS to move themselves out just that little bit further. The vision up on the high ground is perfect for the Radiant side because they've got this nice Observer Ward sitting on the other side. So they're seeing right across the river. But now, okay, so Flyer and No-Tail say, okay, this isn't going to work anymore. But Ennis is also babysitting Crazy. These levels now changing around even further. Crazy, sure, he's getting farm, but he's missing out on the levels. They even missed the rune control with the extra hero supporting here.
Oh, Trixie could get himself a freebie here.
And that's first blood if he gets it. We still haven't had a single kill. He's stalking Ennis. He's really stalking him hard. So he doesn't want to.
For that.
He's coming up for KSI. They're really wanting to just be painful on KSI. It almost feels like what happened to a...
Wow. Really? That back off from KSI?
No, Courier.
Oh, yeah.
Courier, Trixie's going to find it. Yeah, we go. Jumps out. He can use his ulti to chase this one down, and he'll need to as well. Jumps in. The Courier. Speed will start off, but the attack already flies, and Trixie's straight TP out. That's
big snipe.
That's just like getting your first blood anyway with the amount of golden experience he just got.
That was a good decision, not going for the kills after all. The Courier's worth way more, and can't really fault him for that. Nice of Fnatic to play that little detail and see that coming. And at the same time, you've got to say, Era, I mean, he got that bottom lane for free, right?
Yep.
And he's really out farming the Dragon Knight, because he didn't have the top lane for free because of the way Virtus Pro pushed that. They put so much effort into pushing it early on that he lost a lot of farm. Whereas the push bottom from Fnatic was way more calculated,
Trixie,
so they
man.
Don't lose a lot of farm.
There's a Nakes infested. They're looking at the mid. They won't care if they dive on this tower right now. They just want crazy. Jump in, slow down this blink dag, already with the jump out. And Trixie just over the top, and an easy pick up, easy throw down. NS getting troll trapped too. Jesse's trying to TP himself out. Not one, but two kills. Honey getting himself involved in this one. And with Batrider now on the sidelines, losing the extra gold, Honey's almost his blink dagger. We're looking at a 10, not even a 10-minute blink dagger. This could even be earlier with this extra tower going down. And Batrider's got set back even further.
Yeah, it looks like Fnatic are really... They just seem reinvigorated somehow. It's really a completely different team we're seeing now than we did in the first two games, and they're just rolling with it right now. 3,000 on the experience, almost, I think. 2.5. And 4,000 on the gold. We're 8 minutes in. It's looking like a very, very solid start for them. And the question is when the turning point is going to come for Virtus Pro. They've chosen to go for Midas on the DK. They're going for Midas on Prophet. Mm-hmm. So their time to kick in this game comes really late because they're going very ineffective items for the early game. Midas pays off, of course, in the long run. Yep. But right now, their fighting power is really low. And if Fnatic realizes that, they can take the last towers. They have Gen Heal. They'll get a mech very soon. Uh-huh. He has it in 300. He's going the naked mech again. No boots for no tail. I don't know if Virtus Pro can fight back.
I don't think they can right now, man. Look at Trixie. He's even looking for another kill right now. He wants to kill off Ars-Art. Jumps in. We'll start attacking. Supports here from Era. Two hits, and maybe with a little Shrax on, there's a little bit of extra space, but Lifesteal just rages up and enjoys the moment. And this is Warlock going down as he's trying to get to level 6. This must have been like VP's only clutch kind of thing, because DK, like, there's 2 points up in Fatal Bonds, but there's no damage to follow up right now. Prophet Ultimate will help out with that one, but he's gone 4 points up in the Dragon Blood, 3 points up in the Dragon Tail. It's all just full Dragon right now for the DK, and it's... Fnatic just have everything else they need to find. It was also a bit of a raw Blink Dagger from Harney. He did have it by that 9 minute mark, so Blink Dagger's up, they got a Puck Initiation. Even if DK wants to go into Dragon Form, he can't do it. If he wants to cast his stun, he can't do it. He'll get silenced almost instantly, and whatever he casts, Fly will take it. Storm jumping a long way in the mid lane, picks up Crazy, Firefly is off, but in comes Honey as well. Blinks, silence, death. 4-0 already here in the game before we hit the 10-minute mark, and they're also three towers ahead. Or two towers ahead with three towers down.
No, they're actually three towers ahead. Oh, never mind.
Yeah, with the top two.
Damn it.
Yeah.
I saw it exactly the same way. But yeah, the two towers ahead, and it just seems like... It's funny, right? Because after the first two games when Pajkatt said the thing that it's Fnatic that needs to start playing Dota, it's actually been like that. It feels like it's really Fnatic on the aggressive. They're taking the initiative. They're catching out Virtus Pro. And Virtus Pro is drafting some more farm-dependent and passive lineups. And Fnatic is really punishing them for it right now, and it doesn't help them that they're getting double Midas, because this is just like adding fuel to the fire right now for Fnatic, and Trixie's really loving this region.
Yeah.
Oh.
See, it's the age-old debate. What's the better rune on Storm Spirit? Is it a double damage or is it a regeneration? And a regeneration where you could just do that. He just jumped around almost the entire Dire Jungle from bit to bit. And now goes, well, I've still got full mana. I see Crazy, who's now turning himself around here in the middle lane. One quick jump by Trixie would follow up with a Troll Trap, which would follow up by a Blink Dagger from Harney. He's got ulti in 13 seconds. They might be a little bit worried about Illidan. That's one hero they haven't been focusing on. There's an Infest Trixie. Yep, there we go. TP towards the top lane, and Trixie, long jump up. It'll be even longer, but he gets the pull on Illidan, pulls him back, and the one hero which they should have been worried about, Illidan, almost!
Oh! Really, really close. If he would have had 1 point in the stun and 2 points in stats... All right, enough about that.
Don't carry that, man. Don't carry that.
Sorry, I couldn't resist. But yeah, that's a 5-0 for Fnatic. I mean, the reason this is kind of stupid is that we're not actually... It might come off as us mocking Illidan, but it's just such an unusual build that we... It's kind of hard not to focus on it, especially because he made a statement about it, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
We're waiting for him to prove to us that this is a good decision.
And the second he does that, then we'll go, you know what, Illidan? You are a legend. Let's go change that Rosh pit.
Everybody in the expert panel is skeptical about it. I am skeptical about it.
Initiate on Crazy. Firefly, but he'll still stun if he moves too far away. Prophet Alder trying to help him out right now, but he's picked up by Rubick, thrown down by Rubick as well.
Do get a tower in the trade-off, though, so Virtus Pro, they're trying to get on the aggressive right now.
But
they're
also lose their top tier one.
Yeah, they're going to trade with Fnatic. They're already up here. Era and Trixie just continue pushing out that lane after they killed the Dragon Knight there. And, looks like Virtus are going to try to go for a tier two and not going to get this one, though, I feel. Unless if Fnatic just decide, we'll try to trade for both your tier twos, pushing the mid, pushing the top as well, perhaps, or maybe rotating the storm in towards the middle.
This will actually be a trade, man. Unless VP, yeah, there goes Fortification, but Radiant Sight, they've already used theirs.
Yeah.
And VP with four heroes, yeah, they're looking to save the trade.
That was actually a good trade here for Virtus if they hold mid.
Yeah.
Looks like they might be able to. Oh, this is going to be on the. Is going to be borderline.
They might just look for the denial.
Yeah.
Elden's still got the range. It's not going to wear off. And Harney's looking for the last hits. And he's able to get it too.
Got it.
You can see him preparing himself. It's like Bulba. He just sits there waiting for the last hit. Shout out to Bulba.
Yeah.
If you don't know what I'm talking about.
Pajkatt GIF right there. Shots fired.
Shoot him, McGavin.
Yeah. Oh, but it's still. These trade-offs right now are kind of keeping it even. It's about 5,000 on the experience and gold for Fnatic after these trade-offs.
But what's happening here on the bottom lane?
Yeah, they're just letting KSI actually chip away at this bottom tier 3. He's getting half of it, if not even more.
This is the most dangerous thing you can do against Nature's Prophet. If you expose a Rax, yeah, there's already the 4 TP's back. And Fnatic wanted the tier 2 tower on the top lane. Virtus Pro moved everybody up to the top lane after they already pushed out, or maybe not. Nature's Prophet is not everybody. He got stuck in the bottom lane. Trixie and Era again with the TP move. But then, Crazy, instantly on Harney. Harney's the one being pulled back. That's why they're just letting him go. He'll throw his ulti and that keeps Crazy away. He cannot chase and the rest fall out. Very, very smart play. They will lose the Chen creep though. So they get Nature's Prophet. They don't take the tier 2 tower. But everybody goes back out again. But Fnatic lose a lot of life on that tier 3 on the bot.
Yeah, overall, I think Fnatic is going to be all right with this, because the threat that this bottom tower gets pushed again anytime soon is very, very low. Trixie's getting close to an Orchid, at which point he can solo the Prophet. He probably can already, but with the Orchid, it's going to be really, really easy. So it's very difficult being Prophet against this. It's also one of the reasons that Storm Spirit was such a good pickup, because Prophet loves doing the split pushing. It's actually one of the worst enemies he can have. Because what Prophets like to play with is that they know that as long as they can see the enemy, they can feel kind of safe. But Storm jumps in from way outside your vision range and just picks you up and just destroys you. Mm-hmm. And KSI going for the Midas build has absolutely no survivability. Storm is going to be all over him. And with a 7 for nil and a better tower position coming out for Fnatic, they're going to feel so confident going for any sort of kill that they can find on the map.
I suppose you should probably know more about that Storm versus Prophet combination than anybody else, considering your TI2 qualification final.
How was that again?
All I remember is split push, split push, split push, split push. Not a single kill for like 20 minutes.
Oh, there was also some Tinker involved in that, wasn't there?
Yeah,
that was against Mousebots. It wasn't the final, but it was
Tinker and Nature's Prophet, and no one could ever find somebody to kill. And we saw aggressive wards, and Storm Spirit was the only rightful answer. That was with NextKZ.
No, I think you're mixing it up with a game with Mouse, where we were playing against Mouse, and they actually had the Storm. And I think we had Prophet Tinker or something. But regardless, it's been seen many times before that Storm gets picked as a counter to Prophet and Tinker and those kind of heroes, because they're porting all over the map, and Storm is really fast and has a high burst. So he's an excellent answer to that. Not so good an answer to DK, though, which might be the reason they picked him up. He's got an instant stun with some decent range inside that fight when he gets the Dragon Form up and running. And Trixie, well, going for that Orchid build first, he's very fragile as well, so he needs to be clever on his initiation, because he could still get caught in these combos and get bursted down. So far he's been doing well. Well, everyone Fnatic has. They haven't been killed once in 16 minutes. I guess everyone's happy with that. In a way, if Fnatic hadn't lost a tower yet, this would have reminded you of IG versus Na'Vi Game 1 at the International 2, where it was 6-0. Na'Vi lost all their towers at 16 minutes and called the GG.
Yep.
It's kind of reminiscent of that, but Virtus Pro is in a better position in this game, but it feels like all the right plays have just come out from Fnatic. They've barely made a mistake this game, which is really impressive considering how they started off the series. Maybe they were just getting warmed up.
Yeah, maybe that's all it really was, but I'm also looking at Virtus Pro, and now they found their opening. Trixie's going to come in, smoke gets revealed, they're like, wait, what, we got no invis reveal, damn it, and then open up, Crazy's already dead. That was meant to be a trap using Illidant as bait, and it just turns around on the Batrider. Welcome to the first use of his Blink Dagger.
Yeah.
Not really the best. and now Fly, they found KSI. Blink up, Fly managed to get a steal. He just took the trees too. They're going to push this tier 2 tower after dropping down
That's
the
That's a really nice spell to steal, actually. This could allow Fnatic to try to push in the mid. Look at the army they have.
Oh, Storm.
They have two
trolls. Bottom lane jump. He's going on Illidan. Now Nakes also following up. Open wounds. Life leech out of here of Illidan. And NS looking for a stun, but not going to happen. And then instant heal off from Warlock. He was coming in very, very close there with an ultimate. And that's something to be wary of. 3 points up in Fatal Bonds and 1 point in the Chaotic Offering. Just this combination still makes me think that Fnatic don't have this game home and host. Blink Dagger, Lasso in, and then the Warlock ulti with the Fatal Bonds connecting them up. Is it there? Yes, it is. And that is going to be already one hero, but it's the Batrider of all heroes to go down. The mech as well as the Hand of God pops off. And
if they
Batrider
don't get
Nortel
in that burst, this is why the initiation from Virtus Pro has to be spot on right now. If they kill the Chen, they win that fight. If they don't, they lose it. The difference is that whether everyone gets healed 450 or not. It's kind of crazy when you think about it. That's why it's the right hero to open on. It's the right type of initiation, but they need everyone there and they need to burst him down with everything they've got. And then they can try to take the fight. That failed. It's a 10-0. It's a Roche, because I don't think they can fight without Chaotic Offering.
They're going to give her a shot
of cooldown.
The Rock's coming in, and it's going to look for a stun timing.
They're not even full team there.
Nope.
This is suicide if they kill the Infernal off first.
And Trixie's still got a double damage, and he's also got a Nakes inside of him. They're trying to... Yep, there goes the Infernal. It's down. Harney jumps up. Puckoldy will fly Illidan to his Dragonfall, but in comes Trixie. He pulls Illidan in while the Shrak dies on the side where the Infest damage is done. And Ars-Art, well, he is now dead as well. And I would not be surprised if this is going to be not only the end of Roshan, also the end of Crazy, and maybe the end of game number four. 18 minutes in. 14-0. After game one and game two, how it's
crazy.
This
series has officially had everything apart from a long game.
Yes.
I think.
And some people are very happy about that.
It's had everything apart from a long game. Toby, it's like I jinxed it the best I could, right? I have a feeling this game four is going to be really close. You know,
I have a feeling we'll have Cancer Lancer in our next game.
I don't really know, man.
Coddle hasn't gone through yet. It's the only thing we've been missing, really, man. And once Cobble comes in, games are extended to like 50, 55 minutes in. There goes Roshan.
Oh my lord.
Aegis the Immortal now up on the Nakes. And I love his next item too. Not as though they're trying to push enough. Now they're going to go with the Vladimir's Offering on the Nakes.
It's one thing Era loves getting on his Lifestealer and that Fnatic really value, and which I agree completely with. I think a lot of teams underrate the effect Vladimir's has on your team fight. This 5 armor aura and the 15% damage. No!
Ooh!
Somebody die.
Yeah, KSI, he just jumped back past the tier 3 tower and killed up the Storm Spirit with a Shadow Blade. Welcome to the game, man. Welcome to the game. Compact, VP first spills first blood. It is the pebble that starts the avalanche.
And it's profit killing Storm. How ironic is that, right? After we've been talking
and
about how
and
much
And it's solo
Storm
kill, too. That's a solo kill on a level 13 hero, and KSI shoots up to level 12.
Translation, please.
I would like it. I would like it. Yeah, Hugo's asking for it as well. The French was like, give me a translation in French, if you please.
But yeah, they do get a response kill. But if it's the pebble to start an avalanche, they're going to need a lot of these pebbles for that to really become an avalanche, because it's kind of a 14,000.
What? If that's the translation.
Okay. Well,
it's great. It's great.
14,000 XP and 7,500 gold is what we're sitting at, though. And Virtus Pro, it's a hard situation to be in, because they need to find some sort of grip on this game. But can we agree on one thing? For them to have a successful team fight, they have to burst Chen.
Agreed. 100% agreed.
That means Storm gets to fight.
And Puck.
And Lifestealer.
Puck's walking around with a gem, a bracer, and 2300, man. Puck is also a fearful thing.
They need to use single target disables to burst down this Chen now. He's got mech
and Storm.
1200 hit. Oh, okay.
He
good
saw
blink.
The fire and basically the eyes lit up. And he also got Norked out then.
Fast blink from Tame My Wild there. Very nice play.
I can't call him that, man. It just never works. Oh, KSI. Gem from Harney. Vision. And then picked up dead. So, obviously, he should have grabbed some food. He tried to. Oh, trouble right now as well. Illidan's walking up. Iris like, do I fight this? Blink up. Look, it's crazy. He's searching again for Chen. Flamebreak will push him back in again. Now there's the lasso. He's already popped off the mech charge, however, while Iris fighting up against NS, and he will bring him down. Should be able to bring him down. Hasn't brought him down. Warlock will keep him up, and Ars-Art, will he throw the ulti? He's thinking about it. Ira, he's just standing his ground out of all this. There goes your Aegis the Immortal popping off. Illidan picked up, brought back down again, and Nais goes, let's go fight. Orc is up at Illidan. No way to stun. No way to run, and not enough life points. Extra does not live. And it's 17-1. They didn't even get the kill out on Chen. He called out, and he must have popped the Hand of God and said, yep, kill me now.
Yeah, it's very, very, very hard for Virtus Pro in this draft to execute a good team fight if they don't have a good early game, because there's like three targets they have to kill, and they just don't have the damage for it. They need to take down the Chen so he doesn't heal everyone else up. And if they go on him, there's so much counter-initiation coming out of Storm, Lifestealer, and Puck that they can't go in and deal that damage. The only one who can really tank up is DK, but he doesn't have damage yet, so they can just go on the others.
And are they going to finally... Just had a question. Take it all these towers so early on. When's that Tier 2 tower on the top lane going to go down? Just throwing it out there. And also those KSI. Back to farming now on the bottom lane. He's farming up inside the Radiant Jungle, but he's not sure because now everyone's gone missing for Fnatic. Flyers walking around the Rosh Pit. We've got Trixie, who's just farming up inside the Dire Jungle, and Virtus Pro don't know where to go. But they're being watched wherever they go when they're not inside the smoke. Great warding already, and you see the D wards coming out from Virtus Pro.
Yeah, they've got to try to get some sort of map control back so that they can get their farm going. They still have to try to... I don't know what they should be hoping for, because the mid-late game is also pretty tricky for them. They have Dragonite as their sole carry, but he still needs one or two items to go before he can really start being a damage dealer.
They've got to hope that Chen is crazy, moves to the front part of the lines, and then Warlock gets a Feather Bonds on all five, drops an ulti on all five, Prophet hits an ulti with all five, Lashrek walks through, stuns up all five, and Batrider also gets a lasso out in Chen so he can't cast a single ability.
And then they finish them off with Breathe Fire.
Exactly. Level 1 only.
Zero.
Yeah, it's just a single point. And Hilton to the front lines.
Infesting Trixie. I think they're going to go in on the next creep wave here. They don't have a pipe, do they? No pipe available. That's a really good ability to have against Virtus Pro, though. But I think Fnatic might even be confident enough to go
Ruby
in anyway.
Ruby just stole Dragon Form.
Oh, yeah.
He just took DK's Oli Form. Question though, like, he doesn't get all the extra buff ups though.
No, it's not really that good.
No, he becomes mini dragon.
It's cool though, it looks cool.
Oh, look at the TP. It's coming from Trixie. He's got the gem on him, by the way. They hand the gem over. KSI hides
oh,
in
nice
the
Duke.
Best.
Uh oh.
Puck DC'd. Puck DC'd. And Puck is way too. Look at Illidan's arm. Like, the wings are open.
He's not gonna get him.
It's dragon on dragon, man. It's dragon on dragon action.
He's not going to get
the fairy dragon versus the dragon.
Question is if Batrider... Batrider can't reach him either. He's just going to insta-blink when he connects again and then he's good. Or he could orb phase shift. Or he could phase shift blink. Or he could ulti phase shift blink.
Or he could turn and fight like a man.
Yeah, that would probably
he's
be
got
the
3.5k gold, man. You'll just buy back. It'll be fine. He's got a lot of cash. That's when you think about it too. That's basically a Scythe of Vice short by 2k. And
which?
Considering the speed of this game, it's actually not that much.
What puck is that?
Yeah, 3.5k.
He's really close. But I think we might see Hani going for a Dagon at this point. He really likes to get that when they're in a commanding position. Puck with that little bit of extra burst damage, it's kind of the same as the reason you get it on Nyx, because you need that little extra nuke to finish off the heroes alone. And Puck with a Dagon has pretty much the same burst as Nyx does, with an Illusory Orb, a Silence, a Dream Call, and a Dagon. And he can get out again. That's the big difference. He can blink in, drop all his spells, and then orb out. Or the other way around, if that works for him.
Well, while we're going to start a bit of a break, guys, remember, if you want to win a couple of this cool rocket gear, you've got two choices of what you can do. You can go to joindota.com and click on the news article that's there. Write a comment. You can actually write multiple comments. Blame Moose for the spam. But yeah, so, yeah, you're able... Are we going to reconnect? Yeah, Puck just came back in again. So you're able to write a comment in the news article. That's one chance to win one of the packs coming out from Rocket. The other chance is we pick a tweet at random. This will come out from either Syndrin or my Twitter. So Syndrin Dota or TobiWan Dota. Tweet us out, follow us and all that kind of jazz. But what you got to do is tweet both of us. Maybe we'll have to wait. Wait till Hani maybe lives. He just managed to blink, orb, and run, then get himself caught, and then Chen's going to send him back to base. One no tell. Oh, Flamebreak will cancel it. Centaurs, be all that you can be, and get those stuns out. Maybe have a bit of a blind blink out there. KSI with the Shadow Blade running in very, very quickly. Look at the Centaur stun! Three caught. They are all that they can be. And then even they can body block this out. Verse Pro cannot catch up. This is no tell. He goes forward, and no tell throws out the nuke that almost kills off KSI. Hani comes in to They get a kill on KSI! They might lose the army, but no tail escapes. They get a kill. They've only lost one Centaur, and there's more support coming in. TPs are now going from VP to escape. Flies on the way up with a blink dagger and four stuff. If he blinks up here, he finds Illidan. They pick up Illidan, the biggest kill to take. Fly into his extra form. And what's that? No-tell gets a kill on NS. Support. This has just turned into a hunt on what should have been a secured kill on Chen. From a Centaur stun into Fly, chasing down Illidan with his bonus movement speed. He should be in range. He stopped to attack. He's got telekinesis. Blink.
What?
I don't know.
Fly?
I don't. That now. Here we go. Okay, so it's just like building up the suspension.
Oh, here we go.
Illidan, Trixie using close, but he's a little bit too short. Illidan back into the dragon form, back inside of base. The man chasing halfway across the map and then chasing him straight back again. It's like a pantomime all over again.
I can't believe that. I can't believe Chen got away with that.
Not only did he get away with it, he turned around and they got killed.
Fly, use Firefly. I want to see him use Firefly in Dragon Form. Yes! Woohoo!
Really?
Awesome. That's really cool. I don't think I've ever seen that. Look, No-Tail is just spamming as well. Look at me. And then he turns into a witch.
Warlock,
it seems
man.
Like we always need these kind of really unique moments in the defense finals. It's always something silly.
Yeah.
That one is really rare. I've never seen that before. A dragon making Firefly.
See, this is the reason why Ice Frog, we want to have LOD. We want to have LOD. Is there in single player mode for all those guys out there that are modifying heroes, but we need LOD. Actually, I believe too the Russians have set up a private server which does let you do LOD.
There's multiple LOD servers running, actually. Mm. It's pretty cool. There's a website, I don't remember what it's called, but there is one. And it was posted on Reddit, so you can search for it there.
Yeah. Find all your best details over on Reddit. Shout out to all the guys over on Reddit. Hopefully you're having a great time. Yeah. Yeah, but what we were saying before too, guys, so tweet us out, TobiWanDota, SynderandDota, and tell us what your favorite moment of the defense was. Possibly a four-man Centaur stump. We will choose one of the top ones, and we'll announce the winner when the other winner is announced. So as always, keep your eyes over on the joinDOTA forums. It is the best place to go. Forums, news, website. We have this thing called a website. It's more than a forum. Actually, it has amazing tools. I'm going to shut up now.
This is a game of Dota 2.
Sorry, I didn't shut up.
Yeah. Dagon on Puck.
He did go it.
He did go for it.
And it's already
he's
level
got
2 Dagon.
Dagon 2 on Honey, so he can pretty much solo every hero on the Dire side apart from Dragon Knight.
It's because he gets too much life, man.
Maybe he can't solo the Warlock. He has a little bit too much. But all the others, he should be able to burst down with his combo. And it's just a matter of time at this moment, it seems like. The Roshan is going to be up in about a minute, and Fnatic will try to secure that and then push in. Era again has a heart, so they're probably going to run the
KSI,
same kind of style.
Real trouble. Yeah. Just jumped himself in. Gem is there. Static Renman gave him the Flying Vision. And with the Orchid, he's going to pop. So 20-1. It still is, though. The KSI is the only person on Virtus Pro that managed to actually take a kill.
Yep.
Only person.
He's going to mock the others with that before game 5.
Probably.
And
he can afford to buy back and then instantly push the bottom lane.
Oh, is he going to die again?
No. He's going to pop from the Orchid.
Oh, my lord.
And now they go in for Roshan. He spawns up in like 5 seconds' time. This is kind of what Fnatic were waiting for before they push into the base. They want to have an Aegis behind them. And not only will they have an Aegis behind them, they'll have a Nature's Prophet who will still be dead for an extra 20 seconds after they finish this.
Yeah, and the Aegis is probably going to go on the back of Era so they can try and push in the base and end the game. for Fnatic to bring, for Virtus Pro to bring down 3,000 hit points twice with the heroes they have right now and the items, it's going to be almost impossible. They don't really have the damage output. I don't even think they can kill him once with Fnatic around, so he can play really, really aggressively with this Aegis of the Immortal, as well as level 3 Infest. Going to do a lot of extra damage on that with the Nyx Bomb into Trixie, but they're going to give it to Trixie. Makes good sense as well. Storm Spirit is probably top 3 best heroes I have an Aegis on in this game.
Man, 21 minutes in, they're ready to go in. Trixie with an Aegis. Necro books now up for Chen as well. So if Micro wasn't hard enough, Micro is now better. Rubick's got everything he needs. This should just be finishing it off. I still want to see Ars-Art clutch this. I want to see Ars-Art clutch this.
He's almost got Aghanim's.
He's got 4 levels up in Fatal Bonds. Hey, you're right. Aghanim Scepter. Increase up his ultimate. The hilarious thing is, this is possible. This is possible. Trixie's about to jump himself, and you'll see what he's building up. He's not going to go Sheepstick. He's going to go into Lincoln's Fear.
Yep.
And KSI is trying to give some momentum towards the bottom lane. Ulti's on cooldown for now. And there's already an aggressive ward in there. It's trying to give vision for Trixie just to jump somebody. Second he sees somebody. And what's the vision range? Look at the vision range. You can see Illidan on top of the tower. But this arcs up so far inside. And now he jumps. He finds NS who threw down a sentry ward. And NS is dead. And now they go in through the mid.
Kill.
And Illidan's locked in with the Puck ultimate as well. Locked in. Orcaded. No, it's just going to go down. But Warlock gets the ulti off. The Fatal Bond should have gone as well, so crazy. Copping too much damage. It's still going to be 3. There goes Hand of God and the Mech Charge. We got a running crazy off on the side. But it'll be
KSI trying to Rax bottom, though.
Is he? Man, he got the tower.
Yeah, that's all he's going to get, though.
But already Fnatic are sending players back.
They might not be able to get the Rax here.
Era's too close.
They can't even stop Era, can they? It's just going to turn on them.
Heart as well as up with an armlet. Fatal Bonds again though, linking them all up, and Illidan tries to turn stun, but Illidan is dead.
Flies a dragon.
Yep. But he's not a fire flying dragon, so he's not a real dragon. Look at the damage coming out. Era, too far in, gonna get stunned, but then all of a sudden, life points. And they'll be taking out NS. Mega kill streak for Era. What is he on? The one person to die so far for the Radiant side is in fact the Storm Spirit, who's 7-1-11, but it's 5-0 10 up on a Nakes. It's 6-0-8 over on a Chen, and 3-0-10 on a Puck. The Fatal One's almost killing off Fly, but he'll live. So there goes mid-ranks. KSI is still knocking on the bottom door. Harney's forced to come down here to defend. Now at level 3 on the Dagon.
Chasing Warlock. Nope. Never mind. He just open-wounded him and let him go. That's going to be the mid-ranks, and yeah, KSI being hunted by the Dagon, man. And Fly's going to steal it. With the Fade Bolt.
Comes in as a dragon with Fade Bolt. So dragons now masters of magic. Well, they always were back in the old mythology. Yeah. Rubick brings it to life in Dota 2.
Join Dota. Get your history lessons from TobiWan.
Yeah, that's right.
Back when dragons lived.
Back when dragons ruled the land. See, I know that the last dragon was Sean Connery.
What?
If you don't get
that... Was that an actual reference?
It's an actual reference.
I thought that was just completely random. All right.
No, it's an actual reference to a movie.
All right.
The Last Ever Dragon.
Oh, if it's to a movie, then I don't know it. I don't watch films.
You just watch Community.
Game of Thrones.
Here's a strat from VP. Here's a strat from VP. Everyone, go bottom, push for GG. That's the plan. I saw the line being drawn out. That one actually came out from the one man who got a kill.
KSI has like been, he's been digging a tunnel
and
down
now Fly.
Oh! Oh, wow.
Quick blink, faster forced up, and they're like, come on, there's a Rubick on the field. We're going to get the kills, and all of a sudden, the rotation from Fnatic, they come in to help their teammate. Smile prepares himself. His Aghanim Scepter is up. They're ready to fight this one. They are so ready to fight this one. Storm Spirit with an Aches inside of him. Lincoln's Fear is up. His regen's up at 19 HP. Whoop, Harney stunned up. Fly picks up. He can't throw him onto the high ground there, so he throws him up the hill. And then with the dust, everyone gets visible. And now Fatal Bonds with a Warlock Ultimate. Storm Spirit will jump in. No Tail will go down. There's two heroes. Finally, three kills on the board, and Smile tries to stand his ground, but Trixie with a triple kill. Era stands his ground as well in the middle of it all. There's a last two out, they're pulling in Harney, and the GG call is there. That was the combination that we were looking for from Warlock. If that didn't work, nothing in all high hell was going to work. So there, we're going to a fifth game, man. Would you believe it? With two games down, with the games that Fnatic played in the first two, would you even believe we're here in game number five? Or heading there soon?
I would have never imagined game four would be this kind of game. I would have imagined us going to a game five after the game three.
What, 30 for three? You weren't imagining that?
But this one-sided game, I can't believe it. Fnatic just played an amazing game, I have to say. Also some questionable moves from VP, but it just feels like game one where we just said Fnatic got outplayed. This was VP getting outplayed just by even more. Fnatic just complete dominating performance in this game, even more dominating than Virtus Pro was in game one, and that was a lot actually.
Yeah.
But just very, very solid play. There's not much more to say about it. Good drafting, good playing. Very, very intelligent early game, and they just snowballed from there.
Luckily, we'll go to some people who will have some more to say about it, and that'll be our expert panel. They'll be coming up in just a moment, as always, we say, for our last stat screen. But game number five, guys, coming up shortly. Get on those Twitters, get on the Facebooks, get on Reddit, get wherever you got to go, and make some noise about this one. Our final deciding game for the defense. It is a full best of five, no one game advantage, so it brings us to our fifth, and really, it is actually our fifth game coming up in a couple of moments' time. But let's jump ourselves over to the expert panel and see what the boys have to say about what just happened.
All right, holy crap, guys. What a game number four. Toby Sindrin, thanks for the amazing commentary, and boy, what a play from Fnatic. Amazing game. Pajkatt, give us your thoughts, my friend.
Hello?
Oh, we can hear you.
Okay. Well, I think the Dragon Knight. It was cool to see the Dragonite. I'm happy I got to see that. I think that VP's draft was rather awkward, as well as the fact that they went for two Midases, and the Dragonite didn't skill his Breed Fire, so they take a lot of damage in early game, so they can't really fight, and Fnatic could just kill them all over the map because they can't do this. I also don't really like the laning of VP because the DK, Lish, and Warlock, they can't really do that much. It's hard for them to fight or catch a hero. So, they had some problems with ever actually killing anyone. And, just too easy for Fnatic, basically, to just run around and kill these guys when they go for these items and play like this.
Mm-hmm. Boba, thoughts?
First off, I'm disappointed in Virtus Pro for not banning Storm in the last three bans. I thought it was really obvious, like Sindarin said.
It's Could like you rejoin the call, please? Sorry to interrupt you, my friend, but you're going a little bit robot-y here.
Yeah.
Thanks. Just going to wait. Yes, you can go ahead.
Well, I was disappointed in Virtus Pro for not banning Storm in the last three picks. I know Fnatic has been a fan of that hero for quite a while, and it synergized so well with Nakes, and it was Virtus Pro had Furion, Lesh, and I think one other hero at that time. What was it? Bat Rider, yeah. So obviously it's a good hero versus both Leshrac and Furion because they don't have any innate ability to stop him from being blinking around. And then I just thought the game was lost at the draft phase. I didn't see how Virtus Pro could win that game at all.
Yeah, I mean Fnatic executed their draft extremely well. And Fear, let's go over to you here for a second. I mean, Illidan skipping, in our opinion, a very important skill in the Breathe Fire. You know, that's all well and good. If he chooses to do that, then it's fine. But then they go for the Warlock pick with the Fatal Bonds. It synergizes so well with the burst damage that he can dish out. So in the end, it kind of seemed that their draft was intrinsically unsound, even though I still stand by DK being awesome against Snake. So what do you think about that, about VP's draft?
The draft itself would have been okay, but I don't know, they had no damage whatsoever. They needed that breathe fire just so they could kill something. They had a Furion, a Dragonite, which there was only a right-click Dragonite. Then they had a Warlock who only right-clicks as well. Then they have a Batrider who does a little bit of damage, but it's damage over time. And they had the support last track. They just couldn't kill anything that game. They definitely needed breathe fire, I gotta say, on that Dragonite. But, yeah, the way the game was played, they just got ran over just because they couldn't find a single kill on the board, and they just kind of got outplayed the entire game. And it kind of felt like they kind of gave up halfway through and just started just playing for the hell of it and just clowning around, but the game was over really early, and they just, yeah, no damage. Like, this is a reason. Skill Fire Breath, please. It gets you kills, and kills get you victories in Dota.
One of the things I was talking to Clinton about before, like during the draft, was the fact that neither team picked up the Shadow Demon, which is essentially good against both DK or Nyx, and has a lot of synergy with both either Lesrak or the Chen. So both lineups could have utilized the Shadow Demon really well and have had a support that was really good against either side's carry. So
yeah, that's one thing. That's what I was mentioning about the Warlock. I was talking to my girlfriend about that too. I said, why did they not go, for example, Shadow Demon? Instead
they
of
still
Warlock.
Would have lost because they would have had no damage to kill anything. Like, they just had no nukers whatsoever, and like no magic damage was being done that game.
It kind of like, I mean, they had a Dragonite without his
damage nuke.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, having an alternative skill build is all well and good, isn't it? But you don't always have to do the same thing. You know, if you feel like you have Fatal Bonds and Breathe Fire would be awesome, why not go it? Oh well. But the good thing is, Pajkatt, you were correct in your analysis. You said if we see a Dragonite by Illidan, we're going to see a game 5. You got yourself game number 5. So it seems like we switched roles. Malik, what do you think? I mean, game 1 and 2 went to Virtus Pro. They were dominating, and now Fnatic going crazy. Is it the time of the day over there in Russia, or what's up?
Well, that might be, like, there can be several cases of why the game suddenly turned around the way they did, but one of the important factors is the fact that Fnatic caught their stride, and No-Tail's been getting Chen and playing really well on it, whereas his first two games possibly wasn't the best games for him. Another thing is that I think Puck is 4-0 in this series. Oh,
yes.
Was there a Puck in this game? Yeah, there
yes,
was a Puck.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, there's so much raving going on. Yeah, so Puck is 4-0. Maybe it's time to either ban the hero or whoever gets it this time around, I'm going to deem the winner.
All right. Well, any last thoughts before we wrap this up, guys? Game number 5 about to come up.
No more of Batrider mid also.
Follow me at Fear
Dota. I want to see DK again, please.
You want to see DK again?
All yeah. Right.
Well,
yeah,
let's hope we're going to go for that one.
Nice.
Okay. Well, I do want to, before I end game number 5, want to give you guys a big thanks for being on the panel for now. We're going to have a brief chat after game 5, obviously, as well. Big shout out to Team Liquid, Evil Geniuses, as well as LGD International. And with that, we're heading over to Toby and Synd for the last and final 5th game of the grand final for the Defense Season 3. See you there, guys.